It's a pleasure to be with you. The title of this talk is COVID-19 Home Monitoring Program that was designed and implemented by a Native American tribe in the upper Midwest. There are no disclosures for this presentation. Objectives include review COVID-19 disease and risk factors, review the COVID-19 home isolation monitoring flowchart, review major activities of the home isolation monitoring program, discuss the exertion oximeter measurement protocol, and review conditions that will affect oxygen saturation levels and accuracy of oximeter readings. Let's spend a few minutes discussing COVID-19 disease and risk factors. Symptoms of COVID-19 disease include fever or chills, cough, shortness of breath or difficulty breathing, fatigue, muscle or body aches, headache, new loss of taste or smell, sore throat, congestion or runny nose, nausea or vomiting, and diarrhea. This is a graph of signs and symptoms of COVID-19 patients from China. Fever was the most common symptom, followed by cough, myalgia, arthralgia, headache, and diarrhea. Though there are no particular set of signs or symptoms that can reliably discriminate COVID-19 from other viruses, anosmia or loss of smell and dysgeusia or loss of taste are more common with COVID-19. Individuals with symptoms listed on this slide should seek medical care immediately. Trouble breathing, persistent pain or pressure in the chest, new confusion, inability to wake or stay awake, and bluish lips or face. It's currently felt that up to 25 to 40% of those infected will be asymptomatic, but still able to transmit the infection to others. This fact underlines one of the difficulties encountered when attempting to contain this virus. It also underlines the importance of home isolation for individuals infected with the virus, regardless of whether they have symptoms or not. Individuals who are elderly, over 60 years of age, and any individuals with certain underlying medical conditions are at greater risk of severe disease. Though the elderly are at greater risk of severe disease, severe illness is also seen in young people. Underlying medical conditions that place a person at greater risk include lung disease, cancer, heart disease and heart failure, cerebrovascular disease, renal disease, liver disease, diabetes, immune compromise, and pregnancy. This table provides the adjusted odds ratios for characteristics of hospitalized COVID-19 patients in metropolitan Atlanta, Georgia from March to April 2020. Age over 65 was associated with the highest odds ratio for hospitalization, followed by being Black, having diabetes, being non-insured, male, a smoker, and being obese. This table reviews the reports of two studies associating blood type with severity of illness in COVID-19 patients. The New England Journal of Medicine article reported the findings of 1,600 patients hospitalized with severe cases of COVID-19 in Italy and Spain. Type A blood was associated with a 45% increased risk of having severe COVID-19, and having type O blood was associated with a 35% reduced risk of severe disease. A study of 2,173 COVID-19 patients from three hospitals in Wuhan and Shenzhen, China, also demonstrated a similar association, with a 21% increased risk of severe disease with type A blood and a 31% decreased risk with type O blood. A Columbia University study of 1,559 patients looked at the association of blood type with COVID-19 infection in general, not just severe disease. The infection rate was 34% higher in patients with type A blood and 20% lower for those with type O blood and 44% lower in those with type AB blood, though there were only 21 people with AB blood in the study group. While everyone is at risk of getting COVID-19, some people may be more likely to get COVID-19 or experience severe illness. This graph shows the age-adjusted hospitalizations for COVID-19 based on race and ethnicity. Non-Hispanic American Indian and Alaska Native rates were highest at 221.2 age-adjusted hospitalizations per 100,000 population, followed by non-Hispanic Blacks at 178.1, Hispanic and Latinos at 160.7, non-Hispanic Asian and Pacific Islanders at 48.4, and non-Hispanic Whites at 40.1. Non-Hispanic American Indian and Alaskan Native age-adjusted rates for COVID-19-associated hospitalizations are 5.5 times higher than non-Hispanic whites. Since non-Hispanic American Indian and Alaska Natives have a higher rate of hospitalizations when infected with COVID-19, it is particularly important to identify individuals who need hospitalization in these higher risk populations as early as possible to decrease morbidity and mortality for these individuals. Effective COVID-19 home isolation monitoring programs can help identify these individuals early. Let's consider key components of the COVID-19 home isolation monitoring protocol for a few minutes. All test positive patients, along with other patients referred for outpatient monitoring, like COVID patients discharged from a hospital, are assessed by a case manager nurse for signs and symptoms of COVID-19 disease, comorbid conditions, and whether the patient can be appropriately monitored at home, in a COVID monitoring facility, CMF, or through other adequate arrangements. The home monitoring program described in this session is part of a local contact tracing program for a tribe in the upper Midwest. Experienced case manager nurses are essential to plan, organize, and implement the local contact tracing and home monitoring programs. As previously mentioned, signs and symptoms of COVID-19 disease include fever greater than 100.4 Fahrenheit. Fever is the most common symptom of COVID-19 disease. Other symptoms and signs include cough, shortness of breath or trouble breathing, fatigue, new muscle or joint aches, headache, diarrhea, nausea and vomiting, sore throat, loss of the ability to smell, anosmia, or taste, dysgeusia, congestion or runny nose, persistent pain or pressure in the chest, new confusion or inability to arouse, and cyanosis or bluish lips. Risk factors beyond being a member of a higher risk population include greater than 60 years old, particularly those over 65 years old, BMI greater than or equal to 40, heart disease and heart failure, lung disease, smoking, cancer, cerebrovascular disease, renal disease, liver disease, diabetes, particularly poorly controlled, immunosuppression, for example, transplant patients, immunosuppressive medications, poorly controlled HIV, malignancy and chemotherapy, surgery within the past month, etc., and pregnancy. If the patient has any signs or symptoms of concern, risk factors, or comorbid conditions, these issues will be discussed with the patient's clinician and/or referred for clinical evaluation and disposition. The patient's clinician may decide to admit the patient to the hospital or place the patient in the home isolation monitoring program. For the latter, the patient's clinician will discuss the patient's situation and monitoring guidelines with the case manager, who will then enter the patient in the home isolation monitoring program. With no signs or symptoms of concern, risk factors, or comorbid conditions, the case nurse manager decides whether the patient can and should be monitored at home, in a COVID monitoring facility, CMF, or through other alternative inadequate arrangements. A COVID monitoring facility, CMF, may include living spaces like hotels, motels, etc., designated and coordinated by the local civic leadership and public health authority for those deemed inappropriate for home isolation and monitoring. Social workers, if assigned to this program, can help with the home assessment process. This slide describes the activities of this tribal outpatient home isolation monitoring program. The case managers and their assistants will initially assess and monitor individuals on home isolation daily for generally 14 days. During the first contact, the case manager should instruct the patient on how to appropriately take an exertion oxygen reading using the oximeter provided in the home isolation kit provided by the tribe's isolation support program and have them take the initial reading. If that first reading is less than 95%, it should be repeated. And if the second reading is less than 95%, the patient's clinician should be contacted. The daily monitoring calls should include assessment for signs and symptoms of COVID disease, review the oximeter readings from the last 24-hour period, and ask about any other needs or concerns. Exertion oximeter measurements should be performed by the patient 6 times a day, approximately every 2 to 4 hours, and reported to the case manager during their daily follow-up call. Exertion O2 means measuring O2 or oxygen saturations with a pulse oximeter after walking approximately 30 feet. The highest O2 saturation value noted over a 1 minute observation time should be recorded on the patient's oxygen saturation table along with the time of the reading. Oxygen measurements should be performed in a warm environment, approximately 70 degrees Fahrenheit or warmer, with warm hands and fingers. Readings below 95% should be repeated. If a second reading is below 95%, the patient's clinician and case manager should be contacted. Low O2 saturations can be caused by a variety of acute and chronic lung and heart diseases, heart failure, poor tissue perfusion associated with cold extremities, decreased blood volume due to blood loss or dehydration, very low blood pressure, or other diseases that disrupt blood flow to the arms and legs. An irregular heartbeat can make it difficult for the pulse oximeter to record an accurate reading. If a person has a blood pressure cuff on the same arm as a pulse oximeter, the cuff interferes with blood flow when it pumps up, causing low oximeter readings. Generally, discontinuation of outpatient isolation monitoring can be done if the patient is asymptomatic and oximeter readings are consistently greater than 95%. Discontinuation of outpatient monitoring should be discussed with the patient's clinician. This is particularly important for patients with risk factors and comorbid conditions associated with increased risks for severe disease. In summary, individuals with risk factors and comorbid conditions are at greater risk of severe disease and death from COVID-19 infection. Non-Hispanic Native Americans and Alaska Natives have a 5.5-fold higher rate of hospitalization than the non-Hispanic white population when infected with COVID-19. Infected high-risk individuals may benefit from a home isolation monitoring program. Individuals on home isolation monitoring must be instructed in the appropriate use of a finger oximeter. Individuals on home isolation monitoring must promptly call their clinician and case manager with symptoms and signs of COVID-19 disease or oxygen saturations less than 95%.